The summer before my senior year, before two-day football workouts began, I decided I was going to do something different that year in preparation for football practice. So I began to run the stadium seats or the stadium stairs at our local college, East Texas State University. And it seems insane now in July to be running concrete steps when you don't have to, but I did. And a couple things prompted me to inflict that physical suffering on my body voluntarily. First and foremost probably was the fact that the year before I had a major blood clot in the left shoulder, not very far from my heart. It was a result of lifting weights, and a major vein had got pinched off, and spent about 4 or 5 days in intensive care unit at Baylor University in Dallas, Texas. And the result was I wasn't able to lift upper body weights. And the year before my senior year, that was pretty devastating to a guy who wanted to play college football. And I knew that I had to do something to compensate, so I tried to make my legs stronger. The other reason, and this is probably just as equal and of a reason, is that I had done two-a-day practices the year before, and they were brutal. And if you sit around all summer and do nothing, they will likely kill you. And so I didn't want to suffer like I did this year before, so I decided to ease into it gradually and get into shape on purpose beforehand. And the other reason was I really did. I wanted to be the best I could be my senior year in high school. I knew it was my last year. So I prepared at a higher level with a greater sacrifice and focus. Paid off for sure. I literally remember the two-a-day practices not being very difficult at all, when the year before I thought I might never play football again. They were that difficult. But it did pay off. I started off in that year starting on offense and defense. And this is a guy that couldn't lift weights at all. On the upper body, and ended up the year as making all district and all area defensive end, and largely because I had prepared at a greater level. Now, high school football honor awards are not very significant, and the further away you get from them, the more you realize that. Generally speaking, though, how hard we prepare for something has to do with how significant the task is, right? How much we're willing to sacrifice for it depends on how valuable, how meaningful, or how significant the task is that we're preparing for. See, the greater the significance, the greater our willingness to prepare well for it, or the greater the challenge. Most of us prepare for our careers by going to college. As I prepared for my career, went to 4 years of college and spent, I crammed a three-year Master of Theology degree into about 5 years, and I made that preparation step. And many people prepare in many different ways for the careers that they're embarking upon. And people in careers, whether it be music or athletics, still have to prepare weekly, and sometimes to great extent. I know that I've been many times to one of our youth's house, to Esther Seitz's house, where Deanna is a master on the violin, and she is practicing rigorously. If you've ever heard her play, you would think she doesn't need to practice. But if she has an upcoming concert, she's practicing intensely for that. Actors and actresses spend hours rehearsing lines, preparing for scenes, shooting scenes. I read this little research on the raid where we took out Osama bin Laden, and SEAL Team 6, who is already the best of the best in our country, prepared even at a higher level and even more intensely than the SEALs normally do, which you wouldn't think was possible. But the significance of that mission demanded it, and they put forth, and it showed up in the results. So most of us prepare for things, almost always. It may be preparing for your week. It may be preparing for a job or a task at your job. It may be preparing for a test at school or an athletic event or a musical event. We prepare for things all the time, almost daily. But most of us come here on Sundays and never give thought to the fact that we're really, truly, in essence, preparing. We're preparing for a mission every single week that we gather here on Sundays. It's a mission that's incredibly important and becomes more important to me every single year that I live. Incredibly significant, monumentally challenging, and comes with the great risks and great rewards, greater rewards than we'll ever realize on this earth, as we face an enemy, a very literal enemy, not a figurative one, but a very literal enemy that wants to push back, not only push back, but the Bible says destroy the advancement of God's people in the kingdom of God on earth. Very literally, we have an enemy. Our mission is this. Our mission is to make disciples. Making disciples sounds almost harmless, almost without challenge, right? When you say it like that. But more specifically, what we're really doing is charged to come together as a church family to declare the truth of Jesus Christ to a lost and dying world, to a very dark place, and to lead those people who are in that lost and dying world, to lead them to an ever-growing relationship with Jesus. Now, when you are sitting on the sidelines watching that happen or listening to other people talk about it, it sounds harmless. It sounds like, what's the risk? I mean, you're talking about Sunday school and church services. This is harmless stuff. I just had a meeting with a guy this week who God is really invading his life. And I told him, I said, man, if you want to take this step, I am all in with you. And I want you to do these things, but I got to tell you one thing. As you take this step, I want you to not only think that there might possibly come some opposition, but I want you to know there's going to come opposition. And it will come fast, and it will come furious, and it will come unexpectedly, and it will come with intensity and veracity that is absolutely amazing to you and probably frightening. I want you to know that because I want you to be able to call me, and I want you to know I'll pray for you, but I want you to know that preparing for it mentally by knowing that it's going to come is going to help you a great deal. And absolutely, I get an email a few days later and said, it has started. Here's how. Wasn't surprised, and actually he wasn't surprised, and I think that he was able to withstand that onslaught because he's trying to advance the mission, right, by being a disciple, living as a disciple. And it comes. It comes intensely. Last week, we said this. We said we gather every single week to worship in a service like this. We gather to worship together to honor and glorify Jesus so that we can greatly encourage each other to engage this mission. There is something profoundly encouraging about coming together to worship together, to sing the anthems of faith together, to listen as one, as Alan did, just vocalize our thoughts and our faith in beautiful, beautiful music. And then to listen to the Word of God declared to us, to challenge us. We come together every single week to worship and honor Jesus so that one of the great products is that we're encouraged to engage the mission and to keep on going. So today we're going to look at the second essential for that mission. It's something that's most commonly called Bible study. And when I use that phrase, I recognize, even as I prepared, when I say that, I risk about half of us just checking out. It was like, Bible study. Wow, I got up for this, huh? We're going to talk about Bible study. Surprise, surprise, at church, we're going to talk about Bible study. But I want to tell you something. I want to tell you that if you get the mission, that the mission is to make disciples, and a disciple is somebody who is in a growing relationship with Jesus, and that you understand this key fact, that most of what we do in our mission is done behind enemy lines. In fact, I would say 100% of our mission as the church is done behind enemy lines because Satan is the prince and the power and the ruler of this world, that we are in his domain, on his turf, that when we do that, there is incredible monumental pushback. I understand something today that you might not think I understand, and that is when you engage the mission, that there is an onslaught, a very literal onslaught of opposition. Engaging the mission means this. It means that you get serious about living as a disciple, a follower of Jesus Christ, and making disciples, others who follow Jesus Christ. So it's a tough thing. It's not a Sunday school. It's not a Mr. Rogers Bible study time where everything is nice and the world is cozy. This is literally a war. And you may never face the kind of intense opposition that you will face if you get serious about your part in the mission. And yeah, that doesn't sound like a great way to get people to engage the mission, but I'll tell you what, it's better than this saying, hey, this is a walk in the park. Just get serious about Jesus, and he'll make your life kind of rosy and easy, and you'll coast through the end. No, when you live as a disciple and a church commits to live its life as a disciple-making church, you invite a war, and you get it every single time. I have not discipled one man who has not experienced this very truth. I've not been in relationship with one single man over the last year who has not experienced this same exact, very literal truth. When you decide to get serious, I promise you the enemy becomes serious too, because it's a real battle. So here's our question today. Can I effectively engage this mission? As living as a disciple who makes disciples, can I effectively engage that mission apart from regular Bible study? Boy, that sounds like an easy question to me. I wonder how it's hitting you today. Because I wonder if you've ever even thought about that. The fact that you're engaging a mission, and then one of the key components to effectively engaging that mission is Bible study. We're going to look at that. The Bible illustrates it really well. Paul answers the question to Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 16 through 17. I want you to stand in recognition and the honor of reading God's Word. Let's stand together. I'll read. You follow along in your Bible or on the screen. Here's what God's inspired, infallible Word says to us today. Here's what it is inscribed in the pages of this Scripture from Paul to his protege Timothy. He says, Timothy, all Scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be adequate, equipped for every good work. Father, take this word and pierce deep into our hearts. God, we don't need to just be informed today. We need to be transformed. And the Word of God is able to do that today. So speak it into our lives with an authority far greater than my vocal cords will ever, ever affect. Take the Spirit of God in this place and in our hearts and change us. May we be left breathless at the wonder and the authority and the power that is inherent in your Word. It is in Jesus' name that we yield to you. Amen. Go ahead and have a seat. Here's what Paul says. We're answering this question. Do I have to engage Bible study to engage the mission, or is Bible study kind of optional? Is it for the people who want to be theologians? Is it for the people who want to be spiritual nerds? Is it for the people who just don't have anything else to do during that hour? Are these people that just don't have a social life, or do I, if I want to live as a disciple, do I have to engage group Bible study, studying the Word of God together? Well, let's look at what Timothy was told. Paul starts out with this. He says, all Scripture. Timothy, all Scripture. Two words. Paul's telling Timothy that all of the Bible that they had, all of the Scripture, all of the writings accepted as sacred Scriptures, not some or most of them, all of them were included in this statement. That's the Old Testament because, right, the New Testament was being written. So we're talking about the Old Testament here. And he says that they're all included. So he was referring to the Old Testament, but there's no doubt, there's absolutely no doubt, theologians would agree that the New Testament is certainly under the authority of the same truth that it writes of itself. So we're taking all Scripture from Genesis to Revelation to say all of it is included, it's all valuable, and it all is under the same descriptive authority. And look what he says. All of Scripture, secondly, is inspired by God. Now, we can read that and just kind of sound like we know it. We can say, well, all Scripture is inspired by God. We can just kind of rattle that off and sound theologically sound, sound Southern Baptist, sound conservative, sound whatever you want to sound like. But I need us to not worry about those things right now. I need us to look at this with fresh eyes because I think we need that. Listen to the words. We just said all-inclusive, Genesis to Revelation. All Scripture is what? Inspired by God. Does that mean God is just behind the scenes, kind of pulling a string here, pulling a string there, and that men are kind of responding, they're getting a little bit right, a little bit wrong, and then we get this product we call the Bible? Is that what Paul is telling Timothy? That we have a product that God kind of started the ball rolling and then he let it take its course? Or is there something else that we can see in the word inspired? I think there is. Well, I know there is. The word inspired. Theopneustos. It's actually theopneustos. And it's a strange sounding Greek word, right? But I want you to know what it literally means. It literally means to be breathed out by God. So Paul tells Timothy, listen to this. Paul says, Timothy, all Scripture is breathed out by God. That's a very different picture, right? Than saying, Timothy, all Scripture has been prompted by God. It's kind of right. God's the origin, but man has produced it. So it's filled with kind of some mixture of errors and untruth, but the general message is good and true. That's not what he's saying. He said, Timothy, I need you to hear me, that all Scripture is breathed out by God. It's all been breathed out through us, inspired, prompted through the Holy Spirit living in us to produce this document that is inspired or breathed out by God. Listen to what 2 Peter chapter 1 says. 2 Peter 1, verses 20 through 21 says, but know this, first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture, he's talking about Scripture in general, is a matter of one's own interpretation. Boy, haven't you heard that before? Well, that's how you interpret it, but that's not what it means to me. Baloney. Peter says baloney on that. He says, no prophecy of Scripture is a matter of one's own interpretation. For why? For no prophecy was ever made by an act of human will. No Scripture is a product of the human will. Therefore, it's not up to you to interpret it how you want to interpret it. Therefore, it's not up to me as a Bible preacher to interpret it how I think I want to interpret it. It's not up for interpretation, as we would say. It's up to be studied and understood and not to put our own spin on. Have you seen the debates, the post-debate coverage where they have the spin room and everybody's putting their spin on what happened? Their angle, they're coming at it from their angle, their viewpoint. It's oftentimes nauseating because it's so one-sided. On either side, doesn't matter, left or right, it's just a spin. We do that with God's Word, but Peter rebukes us and says, no, we can't do that. Verse 21, no prophecy was ever made by an act of human will, but men moved by the Holy Spirit spoke from God. That's why Scripture is authoritative. That's why we have to study it. That's why we know it's a product of God and not man. That's what Scripture says of itself. Then he says, all Scripture then is profitable. All Scripture is profitable. So he starts down there in verse 7, in the end of verse 16. All Scripture is inspired by God, and all Scripture is profitable. What's it profitable for? What's it good for? What's it effective for? He says it's profitable for teaching. So that's to inform us, to educate us, to give us truth about. And he says it's profitable for reproof. The word reproof, we don't use that a lot, but it kind of harkens back to our concept when we send a net, an article for our connections, our newsletter, and it's proofread. Reproof means to illuminate a fault or a sin. When something's being proofread, it's we're looking for the errors. We're trying to expose the errors so we can get it right. The Bible does that for us. It says it's profitable to expose the errors or to expose the sin and to convince us that we're wrong and that God is right. That's what reproof means. It's effective for reproof. And then it's effective for the next step in that. The logical next step in reproof is correction. It means to show us the correct way. It would be tragic if the Bible just showed us what was wrong. You're wrong. Well, what do you do about that? I don't know, but you're wrong. Isn't that frustrating when somebody says that? Well, if I'm wrong, what do I need to do? I don't know. What do you think you need to do? Well, the Bible doesn't say that. It's effective for teaching to give us truth. It's effective for exposing our sin and where we're wrong. And it's effective for correcting us, for showing us how to do right what we were once doing wrong. And the last thing is it's effective for us. It says training. And training is a military word. It means to discipline or to bring about righteousness. And it literally is talking about that the Bible is effective, and it's the only thing that can do this, effective for bringing us further and further along into the image of Christ, that we bear His image, that we look like, act like, think like Jesus more and more. It trains us to do that. That is powerful stuff. Now listen, if this is just a sermon to you, and I'm just espousing some stuff that might or might not be true, then you know, you can grade this on how effectively I'm communicating or how worked up I can get about it and whether you're engaged or not engaged. But if this is the inspired Word of God, if it has the authority inherent in it that it says it does, then we are holding a document, we are looking at a document, we are studying words and messages that are all authoritative. They don't have a realm in which they cannot speak to. They don't have an authority that they are subject to. They are all supreme in authority, and it says of itself, here's how they're useful: teaching, reproof, correction, and training. That is powerful. And we won't make disciples unless we use the Word of God like that. Because this is the process of becoming a disciple. We have to be taught. We have to be reproved. We have to be corrected. And we have to be trained. Then it says, finally, it says this of itself in verse 17. Why? Why do we want to do all this? Why do we want to subject ourselves to this? Can't we navigate ourselves to this world just kind of on our own whims and our own feelings and thoughts? I mean, who are you to tell me how to live my life? And we lived in the American culture of rugged individualism, and I have my rights, and I'm an American, and you don't have any authority over me. We have all that. Why would we do this? It says, verse 17, so that the man of God, so that the disciple, okay, may be adequate and equipped for every good work. Adequate and equipped. Now, adequate does not mean today what it meant then. This word certainly doesn't. Because adequate means, okay, we're up to snuff, but we're barely there. We meet the standard, but that's all. That's kind of what adequate means, good enough. But that's not what it meant when Paul used the word. Artios is the Greek word, and it means to complete or completely qualify. Completely qualified. To qualify you completely. That's what the Word of God does. To qualify completely. Without anything left, you are qualified for what? What would you guess you're qualified for? The mission. The mission of making disciples. The Word of God qualifies you completely to make the mission or to engage the mission. Then it says it also does something else. It says it equips you. It's a Greek word that means to furnish or fit completely. Everything that we lack, everything that we need, everything that is necessary for the life of a disciple, living as a disciple in a growing relationship with Jesus and making other disciples, helping others live in that growing relationship with Jesus. The Word of God does two things to make sure that we can do that. It qualifies us and it equips us. It qualifies you. It makes you able to enter the game, to engage the battle. You're qualified to enter the battle only by the Word of God, not by church attendance, not whether you stopped using curse words or not, not whether you vote on the right side or the left side of the ballot. None of that qualifies you. None of that makes a flip diddly a difference when it comes to making disciples. He says what qualifies you is the Word of God. God's Word qualifies you, and God's Word equips you, furnishes you, fits you completely. So growing in our understanding and knowledge of the Bible does those two things. It qualifies and equips, prepares is the other word. It's the word we're going to use. When we hear the word prepare, especially as we're describing our process here, you're going to know that we're talking about equipping. Okay? Prepares us to engage the mission of disciples. As I said of worship last week, why you study the Bible matters. Why you worship matters. Why you study the Bible matters. Now, I think that there are two different ways to study the Bible or to read the Bible. Both are very, very valid, and actually both are very, very necessary. I read the Bible almost every day for the purpose of connecting with God, to engage my relationship with Him so that I have fellowship with Him, so that He can speak into my life. He has access to my heart, so that He can inform my day, that He can transform my heart. And then I study the Bible to prepare to preach, to prepare to teach, to prepare to live, to prepare to make disciples. I study the Bible in preparation for going to disciple other people. It equips me and it qualifies me. I am not qualified to disciple one-on-one any person apart from the Word of God. It is my qualification. It fits me completely. It equips me completely. That's why I study the Bible, to connect with God and to grow in my relationship with Him, but also to be prepared, to be very prepared. So, we have a tremendously important responsibility. It's huge. It's greater than your responsibility to vote in November. This responsibility is all supreme, and it's the responsibility as Christ followers to continually grow in our understanding of Scriptures, to continually expose ourselves to its authority and truth. That is our responsibility. Now, in this electoral season, I want to tell you something. I was solicited for somebody to come bring us voter guides. And I said, no, thank you, very politely. And then a friend of that person said to me, and sent me an email and said, Casey, we've solicited a lot of churches in Topeka. You're the only one that has declined. Is there a reason for that? I said, there's a very clear reason for that. First of all, non-partisan voter guides are always partisan. They are. Just by way of the issues that are selected to be put on there. You'd have to be blind, deaf, and dumb to look at that and say, I don't know which way they're trying to tell me to vote. And I want to tell you what qualifies you, it's not a voter guide, to vote right. The way you're going to vote right, the way you will go into a ballot, a secret ballot box, and vote right, is if the Word of God has informed and transformed your life. And then I don't have to tell anybody how to vote. It's not my job. I'm a preacher of the gospel, not a preacher of politics. And the reason we don't have a voter guide here, and we never will as long as I'm here, is because I should not have to tell you how to vote. If you don't know how to vote, then my job is to teach you how to vote by teaching you the Word of God. That's how we know how to vote. That's how we know how to live. That's how we know how to love people and love God. Not by a voter guide. So I apologize if you needed to know how to vote. You can look up a voter guide online anytime you want. But I'm not going to do that for you because the Word of God is very adequate. Actually, it's way more than adequate to do that. Now, Bible study sounds merely academic, and many people shy away from it, from the concept entirely, because they don't get two things. They don't get that the entire Bible, all of Scripture, is a product of God, not man. If you don't believe that, you probably won't study it very regularly. Because you're going to, every time you study the Word of God, you're going to wonder, is it right or is it wrong? And how do I know the difference? And the moment that you pick one point of the Bible and say, I don't believe this, then you have opened up an entire Pandora's box that will constantly invalidate the authority of God in your Word. Because you're going to say, if that wasn't true, how do I know this is true? How in the world do you select what's true and what's not true? Unless we back up and say all of God's Word is inspired because we've said it is, God's Word says of itself that it is, and my experience is that it is, then you're never going to believe the Bible and you're never going to study the Bible. So first thing, the reason we shy away from it is because we don't understand that it's a product of God, not man, and that we don't understand having a growing understanding and familiarity with the teaching of the Bible is essential, not optional. It's essential to living in right relationship with God and others in this life. Those two things are incredibly important to let sink into your heart today, or you're going to spend the rest of your life handling the sacred scriptures of God in a way that has no impact on your ultimate living in your life. So you and I, we the church, are called to embark on a mission. And the Word of God qualifies and prepares you and I for that mission. There's simply no greater purpose for your life. There's not. You can look for it. You can try. But there's not a greater purpose for your life than to engage the mission that God has given the church, which is to make disciples. And the greater the mission, the greater the need to prepare well. And so we are relentless in our pursuit of helping you prepare well. If we as a church have truly forsaken the shallow purposes of gathering a crowd, building bigger buildings, then we can truly engage the mission with a flippancy. If we've given ourselves over to just saying, you know what, let's just do church. Let's just do it like the rest of the world does. Let's do it like many, many other churches do, and let's just be content with a crowd. And we could be successful today if we said we've gathered a crowd. We could be successful today if we said we need just buildings. We've got buildings or budgets or people or whatever, or ministries. But we have said that that's not our purpose, that's not our mission. Then that means we've got to put all we've got into studying God's Word so that we're qualified and prepared for the mission of making disciples. We're going to be unveiling a significant change to our Bible study format in the near future. I'm not going to go into what it's like, right, what it's about right now. But we're constantly trying to say, how can we teach the Word of God more effectively? But as we do that, I want to give you some takeaways today that will help you engage Bible study, regardless of the format, in a more effective way. I think we're challenged right here. I do. I believe that our Bible study format is good, but I believe the way we approach it oftentimes makes it less than effective. So I want to give you some ideas of how to engage group Bible study. Individual Bible study is important too. We're talking about group Bible study here. Let me give you some things that will be very, very important to helping that. First of all, accept that studying the Bible together is an essential part of the life of a disciple. Just accept that in your own heart that it's not optional. Listen, if you want to engage the greatest mission known to man, of living as a disciple and making disciples, Bible studying it together is not optional. Secondly, I want to ask you to make a commitment to attend the Bible study that we do regularly. We tie the Bible study topic to the message that is preached, and there's a continuity there and an opportunity for growth. We do that deliberately so we're not hitting you from four different angles every weekend. You're learning so many things that you never get to pick one thing to line out on, so there's continuity, and I think effectiveness comes through that. Thirdly, make a commitment to prepare well for the time together. And we've made that possible by giving you a devotional guide to fit into your life, to do quiet times by. If you simply engage the devotional guide that we put together, you will come on Sunday morning well prepared to learn and to grow and to participate in the Bible study. Fourthly, help keep the group focused. This is our greatest challenge, on studying and understanding the Bible instead of having group therapy or shared opinions. I want to ask everybody in this room today to do this one thing. If you come to Bible study, and I'm asking you to come, I want to ask you to help keep our group focused on studying and understanding the Bible. Now, here's how you can do that. Keep opinions to a minimum unless they're well informed by scriptures. I don't mean this rude, but we didn't come to study your opinion. Okay? I don't. I mean, but that's as straight as I can say that. We don't have time for 40 people to share their opinions. Okay, it's great. In fact, we have a format for that. It's called Life Group. You can share your opinions all you want. Life Group leaders are going, oh, great, great, we're going to have Opinion Fest. But no, Bible study's not the time to just say, I haven't studied this, hadn't thought about it, didn't read the devotional guide, but I think the Bible's saying, no, stop thinking right then. Just stop and listen and engage the teacher. I didn't mean stop thinking. You need to start thinking. Don't share uninformed opinions of the Bible. Please don't do that. Ask questions if you need to, but don't say, well, I think. All right? Now, keep personal stories to a minimum and use them only as a way of possibly illustrating a point, and this needs to be done with great discretion, or we will be in storytelling land. Do you know what happens in a group when someone tells a story? It reminds somebody else of a story, and they want to tell their story too. And you share a story, and someone says, that happened to me. My aunt Susie did that, and she had the same experience. Let me tell you about that. And 15 minutes gets eaten up of studying the Bible, of telling stories. And pretty soon somebody's going to go, I don't know what that story had to do with anything, but it sure was a good story. And we don't need that. Keep those stories to a minimum. The next two things, ask questions when something's not clear and direct that question to the teacher. Don't just throw it out there for group discussion. Please give the teacher the authority and the opportunity to ask and answer that question. If a group discussion begins to assist, if a group discussion breaks out and the teacher is trying not to be rude, then you can help as one of the students or listeners to assist the teacher in redirecting the focus to the Bible study by simply saying, remember what Pastor Casey said, okay? So this, I'm trying to empower everybody. Let's go back to studying the Bible. Love to hear your story later. Fifth thing is give us your honest feedback regarding your group Bible study experience. Give us your feedback. We want to know how it's going. But if you will follow those things in group Bible study, it doesn't matter the format, it'll be effective. But our group Bible studies are getting hijacked away from teaching time to shared opinions and story time. And that's not effective because this is so important. We cannot let it go unchecked. We have to study the Bible because it equips us and it prepares us to engage the most significant mission known to mankind, making disciples, leading people into a growing relationship with Jesus. Would you pray with me? Father, we bow before you. We give you our time. We give you our heart. We surrender all that we are to you. And Father, if there be one person in the room today that has never, ever engaged a relationship with you, they've never begun the journey, they've never started the discussion, that this would be the day that they know that they can have an ongoing, eternal, significant, and secure relationship with a living God, the creator of their soul, through faith in your Son, Jesus Christ. It was your Son, Father, who died for my sin. It was your Son that you raised back to life to secure my eternal destiny of right relationship with you in heaven. And God, I'm here to proclaim that truth. And so are many other believers in this room. And we're asking you to use us as your voice to sing the anthem of your praise and glory in the message of the gospel and everything we do. We give you this moment in time, and we surrender in Jesus' name. Amen. I want you to stand and respond as God leads you, okay? If there is a need to come for counsel or prayer, please feel free to do so. Go ahead and stand, and we will respond, okay? We don't do this for a long time, so don't think on the fifth verse of this song you'll have a chance then. If you know you need to respond, we're asking you to do that immediately and promptly, okay? Thank you very much. Let's sing.